Hey, what's up, everybody? That's right. This is the Chicago Bears Day After Show with Robbie G right here on Spreaker, Spotify. Hopefully, you get on iHeartRadio soon and all over where you hear your podcast. This is the Day After Show. This is the show that we talk about what happened in the game the day before. It's mostly basically a day after post game show. So let's get into it. Chicago Bears had their second game of the season last night in a loss to the Houston Texans, and that was in Houston. It was a disappointing game in a few different ways, and we're going to get into that, but let's look at the stats first. We're going to look at the player stats. Obviously, we'll go with the winning team first, the Houston Texans. CJ Stroud had 260 yards and one touchdown, no interceptions on 23 of 36. Rushing, they had Cam Akers rush for seven times for 32 yards. Joe Mixon rushed nine times for 25 yards, and Dell rushed three times for 16 yards. CJ Stroud rushed once for negative one. And then let's see, receiving wise, you had Nick Collins had eight catches for 135 yards and a touchdown. Stephon Diggs, 4 for 37, no touchdowns. Joe Mixon had 3 for 25. Schultz, 2 for 21. And Ogumbo Wally had 2 for 20. And then let's see, defense. His name is so weird. I don't even know how to say his name. I think it's 2020. He had nine tackles, four assisted, and one sack. Let's see. We had a lot of sacks in this game. Seven sacks. Will Anderson Jr. had one and a half, and they were just all over the place. That was for the Texans. I'm not going to go over every single player, but there was a couple interceptions. There was seven sacks, so yeah, that was crazy. On the Bears end, Caleb Williams was 23 of 37 for 174 yards, no touchdowns, two interceptions. Rushing wise, Caleb Williams also rushed five times for 44 yards. DeAndre Swift, 14 carries for 18 yards. Homer had 1 for 6, and then Herbert, 2 for 3 yards and one touchdown. DJ Moore caught six times for 53 yards. Adunze, 2 for 33. Carter, 3 for 32. Cole Kmet had 4 for 27. Swift caught 4 for 24. And let's see, defense wise, Edmonds had eight tackles, three assisted, and one sack. Let's see, any more sacks? I think that was it. I think we just sacked one time. Yeah, it looks like, well, we got to Stroud the one time. Actually, no, I thought they got to him at least. Oh, okay, here we go. Sanborn had one too. So did Dexter. He had one sack. So yeah, we had three sacks in the game. Let's see, any interceptions? No. We almost had the interception for Gordon, but that got called back because the ball hit the ground. But it was very disappointing. Defensive wise, it was not. The defense gave up 16 points in the first half and only three in the second half. So that is amazing. Our second half defense is a lot better than our first half defense. I think if we can maybe hold them down a little more in the first half. Last week in the win, they gave up 17 points in the first half. And then we ended up winning that game. So, I mean, yeah, because if you look last week, I mean, it was like almost similar to this week. Yeah, last week with the Titans, they gave up 17 first half points and then none in the second half. This week, we give up 16 in the first half and only three in the second half. So, I mean, honestly, our defense plays way better in the second half. So, if our defense could play a little better in the first half, not give up a lot of points going into halftime, we'd have a shot to win. Now, obviously, the Chicago Bears struggled in a lot of places on offense. Number one being the offensive line. If you have an offensive line that cannot open up for the run game, your quarterback is going to be left out to dry. And I got into an argument with a guy yesterday who just did not get this. He's just pretty much blaming Caleb Williams and saying that it's mostly Caleb Williams' fault. But at the same time, if your quarterback is showing improvement from the next week, then it's not on the quarterback. I mean, he went from 93 yards last week to 174. That is going up, okay, from what he was last week. His first drive alone this week had 55 yards. And this guy, I don't name names, okay, because I don't know if I want to, I don't like putting people on blast name-wise. And this wasn't on one of my posts, so nobody would even know. But basically, he was saying that, oh, well, that first drive was bad because it was little passes. That's how you open up the big passes. Not everything is 10, 15, 20-yard passes. And he seems like one of those guys who's like, well, if the quarterback only throws 2 yards and then the receiver runs for 15, that's not good for the quarterback. Why not? Those yards go to you as a quarterback. That's the job of the receiver, to catch wherever you throw the ball and to make something happen after. That's the job of the receiver. So this guy just doesn't understand football. He watches, but he doesn't understand the game. And I know I'm gonna send this to him so he can listen. And he's gonna talk his garbage about it, but it's the truth. And anybody will know that. Because I got in fights all night last night with people on both ends. So some people agreed with me and some people didn't. The ones that didn't agree with me are the ones who just watch football. They don't actually pay attention. Kind of like in White Men Can't Jump, where he said to Woody Harrelson, he's like, you're listening, but you're not hearing it. You're watching it, but you're not understanding it. Okay, anybody can watch football. I was talking to people last week who were like, oh, well, he didn't impress me. He didn't impress me. Because he only got 93 yards. He's got one more game to impress me. First of all, it don't matter what impresses you and what doesn't. At this point, it does not matter. Because Caleb nor the Chicago Bears give a damn about what you are impressed by. Okay? Do you want Caleb coming to your job and saying, you don't impress me with your job? No, you wouldn't care because it doesn't matter what he thinks. You as fans need to realize, even though you pay to go watch these games and you pay for the jerseys and the shirts and stuff, doesn't mean you have control over the team. They are there to put out a product for you. Sometimes it's a win, sometimes it's a loss. And then I brought up Mahomes, and the guy was like, what does Mahomes and all his championships have to do with it? Do you think Mahomes was this great when he first started in the league? No, he made his mistakes too. Especially in your rookie year. But remember, a lot of these quarterbacks don't even play their rookie years all the way. Mahomes sat behind a veteran. Tom Brady sat behind a veteran. Aaron Rodgers sat behind a veteran for a few years before they even played. They played a game here and there when a guy got hurt, when their quarterback got hurt, or if the score was big enough or they were losing by enough that they put in the backup. I watched people call in for Tyson Bagent last night in the last drive to see if he could win it for them. No, you let your quarterback stay in and make his mistakes. This is how you develop a quarterback. All you wanted people to do was develop a quarterback. Why can't we develop a quarterback? And then when we go to develop a quarterback and they make mistakes, which that's the point of development. Then you guys are ready to put him on the bench and to fire the head coach. Do people even listen to themselves or read their comments before they post them? Or do they just say, this is good and send? Like, seriously, I want to know. You've got a brand new quarterback that just improved. Now, first game, he didn't throw a turnover. This game, he did. Those are called learning curves. That's what you do when you're a quarterback. You make your mistakes and then you realize, okay, both happened out of what could have been a sack. Both of them, he got away from the sack, threw the ball on the run, but didn't really look where he was throwing it and just threw it up, hoping his guy would catch it. Okay, those are mistakes. I saw people, oh, DJ Moore looks mad. He's not mad at Caleb. He's mad at himself because there were a couple catches he should have made. Roma Dunze in the end zone should have caught that ball for that touchdown. Keenan Allen last week should have caught the ball for a touchdown. These are mistakes that are not on the quarterback. These are on the receivers. Now, a lot of it is timing issues. by middle of the season, these guys should be having their timing issues worked out. This is what happens in football. This is how you develop, in air quotes, a quarterback. They make their mistakes. They go out there, they throw some turnovers. Peyton Manning, in his first year, in his rookie year, threw 28 interceptions. He still holds the record today. But people don't get that. People look at the final product of a quarterback. They look at Brady 7 rings. They look at Mahomes with his what, 3-4 rings. They look at that stuff. But they don't understand that these guys were wet behind the ears when they first started too. College is a lot slower than the NFL. When you watch these quarterbacks at USC, at Ohio State, at Michigan, at all these other schools that you watch, Alabama, Georgia, when you watch a Saturday game, and this is homework for all you people out there that don't really watch and you just sit there and like, oh, cool, we scored or we didn't score, whatever. This is homework. Go watch Saturday. Go pick a team, any team you want to pick. Go watch Georgia, Alabama, Michigan, Ohio State, any of them. Go watch a college game, USC, and watch this week. Watch the difference of the time that a quarterback has in college compared to what he has in the NFL. Go watch how slow those lines move in college compared to how slow fast those lines move in the NFL. Then go watch the Bears on Sunday. Watch Caleb. Because this is the difference between college and the pros. This is the difference. People don't understand it. They don't get it. But it's okay. You don't have to get it. Because in the long run, you're going to watch the games every week. You're going to complain when they lose. I had originally picked... Now, if you listen to my show on Thursday, I picked the Chicago Bears to win Thursday night. And I even picked them on my ESPN picks and everything. But originally, now, the show is there. You could go listen back to my show. I believe it was the August 29th episode of my show. I did my Chicago Bears picks, what games they were going to win and what games they were going to lose. I also did it on TikTok, but I did it on my TikTok that got banned. So it's not there no more. But it is still on my show from August, I believe, 29th. And I picked the winners of all the Bears games. And I had the Bears winning number one in Tennessee. I knew that was going to happen. But I did originally pick the Texans to win. And the reason that I picked the Texans to win is because I know number one C.J. Stroud is an amazing quarterback. In his second year, in his first year, he was a good rookie. But he did make his mistakes in the first few games. And then he got the feel for it, which is exactly what he told everybody last night after the game when they asked about Caleb. And he said the same thing. He's like, I had struggles in my first few games. They didn't even win their first game with him. They lost last year. The first game of the season, they lost. And he struggled. He had more yards, but he still struggled in that game. I think he threw a couple picks in the first game. He struggled all around. But if you watch, I did pick the Texans to win that game originally. The reason I changed it for my show this week or last week was because coming off of that win, I knew Caleb would improve, so I thought they would win that game. I called for Caleb to have 300 yards and 3 touchdowns. I thought maybe, you know, he might come out and just go off. But he ended up not. And because of that, you know, I mean, he did have 174 yards. You know, that's an improvement. But yeah, I did pick the Bears to win that game yesterday. But originally I picked them to lose. So at the end of the season, I'm going based off of my picks from the beginning of the season. I'm not necessarily going on my picks for the year. So if they win games that I say they're going to lose, that's even better. This week, I do pick them to beat the Colts. The Colts were horrible against a Packer team with a backup quarterback who really isn't that great of a quarterback. And I don't think he's going to be good against the good teams. I think he just ended up getting lucky and getting the Colts. I mean, come on. It's the Colts. We know they're not good. Nobody said they were good. Richardson is going to get his butt handed to him by the Bears defense this week. Because he's another Levis. He's definitely not a CJ Stroud. And look what we did against CJ Stroud. We only held him to 19 points. We were in that game till the very, very end. They had a chance to win it. When he did that pass to Adunze, I'm like, this could be magic. We could see him run the field and score. But things happen. And that line was just treacherous. Like, it was just horrible. You ever seen those videos for the North Sea on the TikToks and stuff and reels? That's exactly what it looked like. It looks like the North Sea, just it parts and the waves are high and guys are just running over our guys and just running at the quarterback. At one point, I think he had like four guys behind him running at him because they had nobody blocking. I was just like, oh my Lord. I mean, it was terrible. Seven sacks is not on the quarterback. Seven sacks is on the offensive line. And if you think that's on the quarterback, well then just go for the snacks. Don't talk football. When your friends are talking football, just sit there and be like, I'm just here for the snacks. Because I don't know what I'm talking about. And I'm going to look stupid. Seven sacks is on the offensive line. Because at that point, they're just letting guys run free. I mean, this is what the Chicago Bears are known for. Bad offensive lines. Quarterbacks that could throw. We know he could throw from the pocket. We've seen him yesterday throw from the pocket. And when he wasn't getting, when he had the line protecting him at times, he was throwing good. They said the same thing after the game. He was throwing great when he wasn't pressured the whole time. When he was able to hold the ball for at least a 2.5 seconds and throw it, he was making good throws on the money, right where they needed to be. When he was getting pressured, there was no way. Now, a few times it's because he didn't swing his head and look. Okay, and it happens. Okay, you're a rookie, you're gonna make those mistakes. Your timing and this read the defense thing that all these people talk about, it's not really a full thing. Okay, you could read the defense all you want, but if your line isn't holding, you're not going to be able to go anywhere. Okay, and we all know this. If you're talking about this read the defense thing, this is something that you hear other fans say. I very rarely hear them talk about reading defenses in post-game shows, in pre-game shows, the actual talent that's actually played football for a living. Do not say, oh, he don't read the defense. He don't read the defense. I don't think I've ever heard them say about reading the defense. The only time I hear read the defense is out of fans. Why is that? Because it's something that you made up. It's like when fans talk about the airtime thing last year with Justin Fields, his airtime. It was a thing that the fans talk about. You never, it's a stat, but no one really looks at it. You never hear them say, well, his air stats were. You never hear that. Because it's not a stat that's talked about. It's just a hidden stat in the stats. That's it. And when they were talking about that was when he threw the couple screen passes to, in the preseason last year, Justin Fields to DJ Moore. And then he threw one to, I believe it was Herbert. Was it Herbert last year in the preseason? He threw those couple of screen passes and they made the yards, and then DJ Moore scored. And I think Herbert might have scored on that too. And Justin had the two touchdowns. Everyone's like, oh, his airtime was. You know what they look at the end of the day? They don't look at your airtime stats, they look at your stats completely. So in that, he threw like 85 yards in that preseason game because they kept him in for just the two series and then pulled him out. the airtime they didn't talk about. You know why they didn't talk about that? Because it's not a real stat that they care about. Just like reading the defense is not a thing that you hear them talk about. I mean, is it ever brought up? Maybe once in a great while, but very rare. I watch all the pregame shows. I have never heard any of the pregame guys or the postgame guys talking about reading a defense, ever. Because you could read the defense all you want, but at the same time, if you have no time to throw the ball, it doesn't matter how well you read a defense. You're still going to get hit. Now, can he throw the ball out of bounds more? Sure, but he did. There were a lot of times that he threw the ball out of bounds when he had to. But then they got intentional grounding, which is bullcrap. It's stupid. It's dumb. You want to preserve the life of these quarterbacks, let them throw the ball out of bounds without intentional grounding. Because it's better than taking a sack for yards lost. Olin Krutz said this yesterday. And I'm going to respond to this. Nothing is more Chicago than to cheer for every other position but the O-line in the NFL draft. And then complain about the O-line as soon as the season starts. Do you know how stupid that sounds that Olin Krutz said that? Do you know how stupid that was? And I'll tell you why. We have always, every single year as fans, brought up the O-line. It needs fixing. Ryan Pace never fixed it. Poles, not fixing it. He thinks it's good. Oh, we have depth. You have depth, but do you have enough depth that's good? You could have 20 guys, but if none of them can hold back a defensive lineman and a defensive end, then your quarterback is going to be smushed every time. Just like he was yesterday. 7 sacks, 7 times, because they could not hold back. Do I feel that Poles is going to do something about it in the NFL draft this year? Yeah. But are you going to let your rookie get crushed in the meantime? I'm going to send this one out to Ryan Poles right here. The Bears have 8 draft picks in 2025. They have their first round pick. They have a second round pick. They have their pick, 2 second round picks, their own pick, and the Panthers pick. They have a third round pick. They have a 5th round pick. And then they have, the Bears have a pick via the Steelers, which is a conditional on a 4th round pick. So if Justin Fields plays 50% or more of the snaps, it'll be a 4th round pick. He's already played the first 2 games. And they've won those games. Now, I'll talk more about that on Thursday. Because you guys want Justin Fields back. He hasn't been magical himself. 2-0 does not always matter, because you're the same fans that said last week that the Bears didn't win because of Caleb. Well, the Steelers didn't win these 2 games because of Justin either. Justin last week had 156 yards and no touchdowns. This week, he had 117 yards and 1 touchdown. They won because of special teams. They won on field goals last week. 18 points, and they were all field goals. That was not Justin that did that. Because if I could say, well, if Caleb gets them down for a field goal, that counts. And you say no, but then Justin gets them down there for 6 field goals, and that counts, then you're just showing that you are a Justin Fields lover, and you just don't want Caleb here. Because if I could say the same thing that you're saying with Caleb, but you're denouncing it, but then you say that about Justin Fields, then yeah, you're wrong on that. We also have another draft pick via the Dolphins. So we have 8 picks. We have a first rounder, 2 second rounders, a third rounder, a 5th rounder, and 2 sixth rounders. Possibly a 4th round pick for Justin Fields. So that could be a 4th round pick. So we might not have any in the, we have, might have a 1. So we'll have 1 in the first, 1 in the 2 in the second, 1 in the third, 1 in the fourth, 1 in the fifth, and then 1 in the sixth. We could use a few of those picks and still have enough. If we gave away 2 of those picks, we could give away our second round pick. Hell, I would even, if you could get a decent offensive lineman for the Panthers pick, because their pick's going to be better than the Bears. Panthers stink right now. They're already 0-2. Most likely, they're going to be a top five pick in the draft, which means in the second round, they're going to be very close to the beginning of the second round also. So there you go. We could give away their pick and keep our own. But if we could trade a couple of our picks right now for a couple of decent guys, we still have a chance to win. Not only do the Bears have that kind of capital they can use to get a player, but we still have, as of right now, we still have $7.8 million in cap space left right now. We have also, as of now, $72 million in cap space for 2025. And that's if it doesn't go up, okay? So here is the best, as of now, of the positions that are left. Now, we don't need tight ends. We don't need wide receivers. We're good there. We don't need running backs, even though, I mean, I'm not sold on Swift yet, but then again, we also don't have a line to open up, so I'm not really looking there yet. But I'm looking here. Offensive tackles, Donovan Smith is out there. DJ Humphreys, you got Jason Peters, Charles Leno, who used to be with the Bears. Billy Turner. Okay, so these are a few names. Riley Reiff, Matt Nelson, and Julian Davenport. Best offensive guard free agents so far that are still out there: Phil Hayes, Mark Glotzky, Justin Poog, Tyree Phillips, Justin McCray. You still got Dennis Daly. I mean, these are still guys that are out there. Best centers: Mason Cole, Scott Quisenberry, Brian Allen, Pat Elflin, J.C. Hasner, Cameron Tom, and Ricky Stromberg. Okay, so we still have a bunch of centers, a bunch of guards, and a bunch of offensive tackles out there. Okay, so you got $7.8 million in money left. These guys at this point aren't going to cost that much. Maybe you can get a guy for $3 million for the year. Maybe you sign him to a one-year prove-it deal, see how he plays, and then go from there next year. The point is, you have free agent money, and you still have draft picks to trade. So you find a guy, you find somebody out there, and they're like, oh, you know, maybe we go out there and we get this guy for one day, you know, or for 1 year and see what he does. There you go. Or we trade and use a few draft picks. Or we do both. Get one free agent and then and maybe trade for two more guys. Bring them in and see what they can do. They can't be worse than what we got right now. But, I mean, these guys are still out there. There's still some edge guys out there on defense if we wanted to sign one. We could bring in Yannick Ngakoue. I mean, he was good. Marquise Haynes is out there. We still got some guys out there. I think defensively we're good right now. I wouldn't necessarily use my money on that. And look at best safety free agent out there right now. Micah Hyde is still out there. He was pretty decent. We could always use some safety help. But yeah, I mean, if you're the Bears, you know you're set for now in quarterback. You're not looking at a quarterback right now because you're looking to fix the issue at hand. The issue was never necessarily Justin Fields. The issue was the offensive line. And I'll say that now, is Justin Fields turning eyes and heads over in Pittsburgh? I don't think so. Now with 156 last week and 117 this week. I mean, this week, our quarterback did better than him. I mean, turnover-wise, he didn't. Justin Fields hasn't thrown an interception yet. He did fumble a snap last week, but he hasn't had any turnovers yet. But he hasn't really done anything else either. So, yeah, I mean, if you look at it, I'm sticking with what you got now. I'm sticking with Caleb. I think Caleb's fine. I think he's going to be great. He's going to be a great quarterback for the Bears. He's going to be the franchise quarterback for this team. Because he's already improving from week 1 to week 2. And that's all you can ask out of a quarterback. We didn't have that with Justin Fields here. So I get it. You guys are like, oh, we should have kept Justin, and we should have drafted Marvin Harrison Jr. Last week, Marvin Harrison Jr. had one catch for 4 yards. I mean, this week, yeah, he went off. But last week, he didn't. So we don't know what he would have been here in Chicago. Okay? Stop with the we should have, would have, could have, Joe Alt, and all this stuff. Stop. Because we don't know what they would have did here in Chicago. We know what they're doing with the Chargers. We know what they're doing with Pittsburgh. We know what they're doing with Arizona. Okay? This is Chicago. It's completely different here. They could come in here and totally stink. Okay? We don't know yet. And we'll never know. So at this point, you stick with what you got. You keep the players you got here right now. And we go from here. Really quick before I go, we're going to look at the schedule for the Bears right now after the first two games are done. Exactly what I've called in my original post on TikTok and on my radio show on August 29th. Listen back. I'll tell you who I said was going to win the games. I didn't listen back to it, but I'm pretty sure I remember who I picked for all these. And I know it was the Tennessee Titans. The Bears are going to win there and then lose to the Texans. And now, here's the rest of the Bears' schedule, at least for a little while. Okay, so we've got the Colts. That's a win. Next week, we're going to beat the Colts. We got the Rams. I think that's a winnable game. I said they were going to win that one. Panthers, definitely a win. Jaguars was going to be a win. Commanders, that's a little up in the air right now to me. I'm not sure how I would go on that when I do my weekly picks. My weekly picks sometimes are different from what I picked in that original post because I'm seeing different things as the season goes on. That was a pre-pick of what I think they were going to do. Okay, if I see better or worse, I might call some losses that I didn't call last time, and I may call some wins that I didn't call. Let's see. Commanders, that's iffy. We'll see at that point. I think we could beat the Cardinals, but then again, it depends on Kyler Murray looked good yesterday, and so did Marvin Harrison. That could be a connection that we have to watch for the rest of the year. Could be a connection that could take them into the playoffs. Patriots and Bears, I think Bears could beat the Patriots. Packers and Bears, we got to see Jordan Love, how if he's back by then and how he plays when he comes back. Our defense is pretty tough this year. Obviously, in the first two games, we only allowed 17 and 19. And so we'll see what they're going to do. This could be a win for the Bears like I picked. Because I picked the Bears to beat the Packers once. And it could be, but we'll see. 3 to 6 weeks for Jordan Love. If he's the six-week mark, he should be back by that point. Because there's a bye week in here, too, for the Bears. So that's not even showing up on here. So I don't know when the Packers' bye week is. I'd have to look. But, yeah, he should be back by the time they play the Bears in November. Vikings and Bears. Vikings are going to lose to the Bears. Vikings, even though they're 2-0 this year, I think that, you know, they're gonna hit their wall eventually. I don't think the Vikings are going to be a threat in the NFC North. I don't, not in my opinion. But that's only 2 weeks in. We'll see what happens. You could look good in the first 2 weeks and then be crap the rest of the year. And it happens. Okay? Nobody was expecting Sam Bradford to come in and do what he did. But now that he's there and they could watch a few weeks of film on him, a lot of people could turn him around into what people think he's going to be. Lions and Bears. I said the Bears were going to take one against the Lions out of two. And I think they're going to take the Thanksgiving Day game. We got the 49ers, possibly winnable. Vikings, I think we still sweep them. As of now, it could change depending on how they play. Lions are going to take one out of two, so they'll probably take the one at the lakefront. Bears over the Seahawks the day after Christmas, and then January 5th against the Packers. Depending what we do in the first game of the Packers, I still think we split with them. But then again, maybe Jordan Love comes back not as good as he left, as when he left. You know, I mean, injuries can do something crazy to people. It could turn guys into not having a good season. He could have a lingering issue for the rest of the year after this, and he could struggle. We don't know. So we'll see. I'm not going to call anything with that. This is just preliminary. So we'll see what happens. But like I said, Chicago Bears 1-1, exactly where I picked them to be on August 29th. We'll see what happens now. We got the Colts this Sunday. We'll talk more about that on Thursday when we talk NFL Week 3. But Bears overall, I'm happy with where they're at. I'm happy with Caleb. I think that he did make strides yesterday to show he can improve, which is what you want out of a quarterback when you are developing him the right way. They want him to make his mistakes early so that he can learn from them early. I got a bet going with two friends. Well, my friend and his brother-in-law, who I'm considering a friend already. He's a cool guy, and I think that he is, you know, pretty decent with the way he was talking yesterday with me and stuff. We were going back and forth on the Bears. I think he was good at what he was talking about. He knew what he was talking about. But yeah, I definitely think that the Bears have a pretty good chance of still winning the 10 that I told you they were going to win. Actually, I think I picked them to win 11. But that could change, like I said, a lot could change during the season. When you make your preliminary picks, you're doing it based on paper. Okay? You're doing it on paper. I don't really look at preseason too much because preseason could be nothing. But I was looking at it like this. I looked at it and said, yes, I do believe that the Bears have a chance to win 11. I'm saying 10 or 11 still. Texans was a loss originally, so that doesn't count against my 10 or 11 wins. But there you go. We'll see. I think that we beat the Colts. I think the final, I'll talk about this more on Thursday on my other show where we talk full NFL Week 3 news for all the teams. But I do believe that this team is going to win 10 or 11 games this year. I think Caleb is going to end up with a good season. I think Caleb Williams still ends up with, I said 3,500. That's the bet. Yes, that 3,500, or I have to pay for their fantasy next year, because we pay like a $20 buy-in. So, $20 buy-in, if they both play next year, I'll owe 40 for them. If I win the bet and they get over 3,500 yards, he gets over 3,500 yards, I don't know how this works with them. I don't know if they're going to split it together. That seems kind of unfair. So we didn't really talk about that too much. So we'll see. I don't care. I just like to have my fantasy paid for. I don't really care how they do it. I don't know if they're going to split it or if they just one gives me 20 in cash and the other one pays for my thing. I don't know how they're going to do it. But the point is, or they each give me 10 and then they put 10 towards my thing. However they want to do it, the point is it was a $20 pretty much bet. And I still have a chance at that. There is 15 games left on the NFL season. Right now, okay, so 3,500 minus the 174 that he got yesterday, minus the 93 he got, that's 3,200. That's 3,233 left. Okay, so if he gets 250 times 15 games, that'd still be another 3,700 yards. If he averaged 250 a game, that's not even that much. There's quarterbacks putting up that could put up 300 to 350 yards a game. Okay, that's used to be the norm in the NFL. Guys put up 300 yards a game. Okay, like this NFL now, I think more guys run. But okay, so if he got 200 yards times 15, that's another 3,000. Plus the 174 and the 93 would leave me short. So basically, he has to get... Okay, so here. I'm doing the math for them because I'm going to send them the show to listen. 3,500 minus the 174 minus the 93. So divide that by 15 games. He'd have to average 215 a game to get that. Okay, and then 30 touchdowns. He has to get 30 touchdowns. I think the one guy is about me, and that has nothing to do with the touchdowns. It's just the yardage. But 30 touchdowns and 15 divided by 15 games, he only has to average 2 touchdowns a game throwing to get 30 with 15 left. That's not hard to do. I mean, if he really hits his stride, Keenan Allen gets healthy, you've got DJ Moore, you've got Adunze. Where was Scott yesterday? Scott was active. Why did they not play him to see what he could do in there? Like, I'm really questioning these coaches and what they're doing here. Like, why did Scott not play? Where is Roschon Johnson? Why is he not coming in? Why are we bringing in Homer? I just don't. We got these guys just sitting there. At this point, if you're not going to use them, cut them. Let them go somewhere else and use that room and that cap space that you would have to bring in someone you're going to utilize. Because to me, Roschon Johnson should be playing. Scott should have been playing. Your four wide receivers should be DJ Moore, Keenan Allen, Rome Odunze, and Scott. All four of those guys in order right now. But when he was out, when Keenan Allen's out, it should have been DJ Moore, Rome Odunze, which it was, then Scott, then this Carter guy who was okay. He was making catches. But at the same time, why do you have Scott here if he's not going to play? He was a rookie last year. He improved. Let him try. Let's see what he can do. I don't know. Well, we'll talk about this all next week. Hopefully next week's going to be a better show. Hopefully we're going to be talking a Bears win. Hopefully we're going to be talking about a very good, play out of Caleb Williams. I think next week, obviously, the defense of Indianapolis is not good. So hopefully Caleb's going to pick them apart, and that's a confidence builder. I don't want to hear any of you idiots out there saying, oh, well, he played against the Colts. It doesn't matter. That's a confidence builder. This is how guys come out, and they get confidence, and they play tough. This is what happens. So stop. The NFL, any given Sunday. There's a reason they call it any given Sunday. Anybody can win. Anybody can lose at any time to any team. But let's go, Bears. Hopefully we get the win Sunday. We're going to talk more about the Bears and all the other games this week coming up on week 3, starting Thursday night. So we'll talk about it Thursday on my show. And let's go get a W. Let's do it. But here we go. I'm taking off for the day. Hope everybody has a great Monday. Definitely check out the Monday Night Football game today. Who's playing in that game? Eagles and Falcons, that should definitely be a decent game. So, yeah, definitely check that one out. And I will see everybody on Thursday. We will be talking about Bears football, regular NFL football, NCAA football, week 4. We'll also be talking about the Emmy Awards. Yesterday was the Emmy Awards, and I will let everybody know who won all the Emmys. For that, we're also going to talk about where Beetlejuice was at the box office this weekend. Did it keep its number one spot, or did Deadpool and Wolverine get back into the number one? We'll find out, and we'll also talk about some other stuff too. So we got some Blackhawks. We'll talk about their preseason games coming up. Chicago Bulls got their preseason coming up. We'll talk about that too, and we're going to have a good show Thursday. Check it out this Thursday. It'll be on Spreaker at 5 o'clock. This show, make sure you listen to it, and then next Monday I'll be back to talk about it again. So I'll take off now. See everybody later. Peace.